Bring in DA Davidson's Tom White, who's able to join us and follow up on this. Tom, do you feel like the jump in revenues for Eats sufficiently offset the fall for mobility?
Yeah, first off, thanks for having me, guys. Busy earnings night tonight for everyone, I imagine. Look, I think as far as the numbers tonight, you know, as Deirdre mentioned, the top line trends were pretty well digested by the street. I think it's really the EBITDA line that people are going to be focused on, and particularly whether EBITDA losses are on track to kind of narrow here over the course of the next few quarters. Sounds like, per the language in the press release, that appears to be the case. You know, the other issue I think that's going to be important, this will probably come up on the call, is just how have trends been thus far in the third quarter? We know in ride sharing it was down around 75% in gross bookings for the quarter, but exiting the quarter, their core ride sharing business was down less than 50. Some of the online travel companies we've heard from this earnings season talked about kind of a let up or you know, incremental pressure kind of mid-July on kind of that recovery trend that they were seeing. And, you know, Uber's not exactly a travel company. It's more of a transportation company. But we'll be curious to hear whether or not, you know, U.S. trends in ride sharing kind of maybe took a step back a little bit.
The stock is down 2.6% after hours. Tom, it did have a nice little run up here into earnings. What do you think Wall Street cares more about at this point? For so long, it was, we're going to be profitable, we're going to be profitable, we're going to be profitable in the ride sharing. But now, is it more about the Eats business?
I would say it's more about the Eats business. I mean, look, I think generally investors want to see a balanced approach to growth and profitability. And, you know, there's a lot of noise impacting the second quarter numbers, and these guys give a ton of disclosure. So it's possible that, you know, depending on what metric you're focused on, maybe you were happy to see what you saw or a little bit disappointed. I don't know that I'd spend too much time on the 2Q particulars. I think if you step back, we really think that Uber squarely fits into this group of companies that will emerge stronger as a result of this pandemic. You know, that's maybe more obvious in online food delivery, where the entire category is just enjoying this pull forward of future demand. But also in the rides business, we think competitively speaking, you know, the fact that Uber's been able to maintain engagement with both drivers and riders, or consumers and drivers, because they offer an Eats business, that's going to make it easier for, we think, their ride-sharing business to kind of grow, you know, kind of in the early parts of a true recovery post-pandemic. Right? Some of these ride-sharing peer players that Uber competes with, no one's opened their app in, you know, 3, 4, or 5 months. So, you know, we think there's a strong case to be made that Uber's Eats business is structurally bigger because of the pandemic, and then they're also competitively in a better position on the other side of the pandemic in their core ride-sharing business.
Yeah, albeit Uber Eats and Uber Transport are different apps on people's phones. Anyway, we passed the moment, Tom, where people still question whether this company could run out of cash, whether it will become profitable before it burns through its existing cash base?
Yeah, look, I don't think that that's a big concern for investors right now. These guys have proven that they can, you know, tap the capital markets, raise money. We think they've got several years of being able to you know, preserve cash. Even presuming, you know, the business in core ride sharing is down 75% for, you know, a year or so, which we really don't think is particularly likely.